Hello and good evening, dear viewers. Welcome to episode number 11 of BMC Global Live Al Hilal Health World. I'm Gauri Priya, and with us we have Dr. Rajini Ramachandran. She's a gynecologist with 13 years of work experience and is currently working in Al Hilal Medical Center, Selmabad. Before we move on, please do not forget to like and share our Facebook page. Also, like, share, and subscribe our YouTube channel. Hi,
hello,
Doctor.
Gauri.
Welcome to another episode. So last episode, we had talked about the risk factors affecting the pre-pregnancy care and what are the importance of pre-pregnancy care. What are we going to look upon to this episode?
Yes, Gauri. Last time I spoke about what pre-conceptional care is all about and how it is done, how we assess risk factors and what are the risk factors are all about. Now I'll be talking about how you can modify these risk factors and so that the patient doesn't get into any problem during her pregnancy when she really decides to get pregnant.
Okay. So how is it done, doctor?
Well, the very first thing that I would want to shed some light on would be nutrition and the supplementation that we can give when a patient contemplates pregnancy.
Okay.
It should be initiated almost 3 to 6 months before you plan a pregnancy.
Okay.
And basically, we ask these patients to take folic acid. 400 microgram is the daily recommended dose for women who are like want to get pregnant in the coming few months. So we cyclically ask them to take every cycle folic acid. The importance of folic acid is it prevents a lot of neural tube disease. Like neural tube is the one that becomes the brain, the spinal cord and the skull later on in a baby's life. So by the time, as I told you, the pregnancy test becomes positive at the fifth week, the neural tube is already closed.
Okay.
Its full development is already done. So that is why it is so important to supplement folic acid before she even becomes pregnant, because the use of folic acid comes down after the pregnancy is detected.
Okay.
So that is why we ask patients to have anyone who's trying for a pregnancy to start folic acid supplementation. But I would also want to add a word, like, you know, suppose a patient is on anti-epileptic drug.
Okay.
Epilepsy means you get seizures, that is fits.
And
in these patients who get seizure disorder, they are on drugs. And these are like, you know, these patients need a higher amount of folic acid that then we advocate around 5 mg of folic acid daily. So also if patients have, like I told you, we take obstetric history, the previous history, they have had malformed babies in the past and recurrent abortions. In that case, we advocate them to take 5 mg daily dose.
Okay.
And also iodized salt and having nutritious diet, more fruits and vegetables, they're rich in antioxidants, limit the amount of uncooked meat and raw meat, because toxoplasmosis is very common in, it is transmitted through uncooked and poorly prepared meat.
Okay.
So these are some things that you have to take care of, and this is the modification we tell women who are planning pregnancy.
Should fast foods be avoided?
Yeah, definitely. They're highly processed food. So refined carbohydrate, fatty diet, and that causes a lot of constipation, difficulty in digestion, and the glycemic index is very high. So they fall prey to high sugars. So it is better to avoid fatty, oily food.
Okay. So what is the next modification that we
So, yeah, I just told you about nutrition. The next would be like about optimizing your weight.
Okay,
so we just, I just told you during the physical examination part, if I see a woman's BMI is more than the ideal BMI, that is, you calculate it with a calculator, like height by the weight, so weight by height square. When you do that, you have to have a BMI of, you know, around between 18 to 24.9.
Okay.
Suppose your BMI is over 29, you are in the overweight when you are like 29, and about 30 it is obesity. So you have to tell the patient that maintaining an optimal BMI and maintaining it at that level is very important for a successful pregnancy and a baby outcome. So this is done by asking them to exercise daily at least 30 minutes 5 days a week. Goes a good does good to the patient if they are trying for a pregnancy. And this has to be done even before they're thinking about a pregnancy. Okay. When you already come with a pregnancy, you cannot do much about your weight. In fact, you will be gaining more weight each trimester. Yeah. So this has to be. And there are some women who are like, you know, undernourished. BMI is way too low. They are not eating properly. They suffer from anorexia nervosa. And there are women who gym a lot.
Yeah.
Gymming is like, has a lot of effects on the body too, in a negative way, in the sense that over gymming and over exercise causes irregular periods and cessation of periods.
Okay.
So if you're planning on pregnancy, have a moderate workout, eat moderately, and sleep well, and choose your food intelligently. That goes a long way in having a healthy motherhood and a healthy baby.
So being overweight can affect the baby.
Yeah, okay. Definitely, because during the pregnancy you might have high sugars, you might fall prey to high BP, and when you have high blood pressures you might have placental abruption. Lot of problems, adverse outcomes can result from being overweight.
Okay. So dear viewers, we'll be now going for a short break. You're listening to BMC Global Live Al Hilal Health World. Today with us we have Dr. Rajini Ramachandran, and we'll be back soon. So, doctor, what are the modifications that we give to a person who has addiction or a person who is infected with HIV?
Well, addictions, Gauri, like I already told you in the last episode, like how smoking, alcohol and substance abuses like marijuana, cocaine has deleterious effects on the growth of the fetus. It hampers organogenesis and causes a lot of abnormalities in the baby. Yeah. So they have to be told before they embark on this journey, they have to be told the importance of stopping it altogether, not just reducing the use. Any amount of alcohol will have a bad effect on the fetus. So they need to understand, they have to meet a counselor, take medications that, you know, that help them withdrawal symptoms, and finally get them to understand how important it is to remove such substances from your body, causing damage to your body and then causing damage to your unborn child.
Okay.
So that has to be done with a little of patience, and only when she is like off all these substances should she even think about a baby.
Okay. What about a person who is infected with HIV?
HIV and other sexually transmitted diseases, like we'll have to screen the patient. I told you already when we run the lab test. So when you see someone is positive with the hepatitis B or HIV or VDRL in such cases, or pelvic infections like chlamydia, such diseases like gonorrhea, then you'll have to give necessary treatment for the same. Like in HIV, we refer them to a physician and he sees the viral load, and if the viral load is really high, she cannot be thinking about pregnancy right now. He might start her on retroviral therapy, antiretroviral therapy, and also, you know, see if she suffers from other coexistent infections. And after having done and ruled out, only after he gives a green signal that yes, now the load is less enough for her to, you know, think about a pregnancy. So that is only time she can even try thinking, because the chances of the infection reaching the child is very high if the viral load is high. So for chlamydia and all that infections, vaginal infections, you just give them a course of antibiotic, call them back again and see that everything is normal. Only then she can think about a pregnancy.
Okay. And here, mostly due to the lifestyle, most of the women, they are having diabetes, and how do we treat those people?
Yeah, so I was going to come into the, you know, how to tackle conditions like chronic disorders that women already are suffering. Diabetes is one thing that is a major killer, like, you know, it can affect both the mother and the child and the baby, so the unborn baby. So what we see is, like, we run the blood sugars and see how the glycosylated hemoglobin or HbA1c, it gives you insight into how her blood sugars have been in the past 3 months, and there has to be a strict and a tight control of her sugars, and the HbA1c should be maintained at around 6.5. And the patient might be on some drugs that are not allowed in pregnancy. So if she's like, as I told, preconceptional care starts around 3 to 6 months before you're trying to, you know, thinking about pregnancy. So during this time, these drugs can be replaced with something that is not a problem in pregnancy. And also she can go for walking, get her sugars in normal, and then check all her kidney profile, liver profile, check her, get her eyes checked for retinopathy, and then embark on this journey. So that diabetes has very bad effects on the pregnancy, like you have a bigger baby, and when you have a bigger baby, there's a lot of water which is called polyhydramnios around the baby. And so because of these, there are like placental abruption, bleeding during pregnancy, sudden intrauterine death, that is the baby just you know, the heartbeat stops. So such accidents are very common when you have diabetes in pregnancy. So these things also leads to emergency cesareans, and because the baby is not bigger, the shoulder is bigger, there will be shoulder dystocia, birth trauma is more, and then landing up in cesarean section. So these unwanted complications can be just avoided by getting into pregnancy with a normal sugar values, which is properly controlled with the proper drug that you're allowed to take during going into pregnancy. Then come in with some drug that you've already taken and the damage has been done. You come with a 13% HbA1c at 3 months. We just cannot do anything, because during the stage the organogenesis happens. I told you all organs are formed by 9 weeks, that is around 2.5 months, and the sugar is surging in the blood, maternal blood, at high levels can cause lot of damage to the heart, and the baby can be anomalous. So this is the importance of controlling your sugar before you get pregnant.
So doctor, what is the effect of high blood pressure?
This is another condition which is also chronic disorder, and usually women with uncontrolled hypertension will have a lot of problems when they're already pregnant, and you can do nothing about it. They might be on drugs that are not allowed in pregnancy. Like there could be a woman who must be thinking, okay, my BP is all good, I'm having my medicines on time, but sadly she'll be on ACE inhibitors, which are not allowed in pregnancy. They're contraindicated in pregnancy. So before you are planning pregnancy, 3 to 6 months before, you must go to your physician and discuss the desire to be pregnant, and he will slowly stop those drugs, taper it down. It's not like abruptly stop the medication you are on, but slowly taper it, reduce the dose, put in another dose, and slowly increase the dose. Titrate it according to your BP, and by the time you're pregnant, it is in the control state with a proper drug, so that hypertension also in pregnancy can cause a lot of kidney damage to the mother itself. It can cause a lot of placental problems, growth retardation, problems relating to surgeries, emergency surgeries because of intrauterine death and bleeding problems, abruption, and many adverse effects are known with if you have high BP, conditions called preeclampsia, where you throw in seizures, and it's a real difficult condition to treat when you're like pregnant. So we advocate to the woman to, you know, what drugs she can take if she's planning pregnancy, and her blood pressure should be at this particular level, and see that she's fully controlled, her blood pressure is in the normal range before she goes in for a pregnancy.
What about thyroid disorders, doctor?
Thyroid disorders, as you know, Gauri, are very common actually in women especially. So it is very necessary when a woman is taking thyroid tablets, the TSH, that is the thyroid stimulating hormone, levels in her blood should be maintained at less than 3 when she starts her pregnancy. This is very essential, and that has to be maintained all through the pregnancy. So we tell her the importance of having normal thyroid levels, why it is so important, because it has effects on the baby. Also, some people suffer from hyperthyroidism, and most of the women might be on carbimazole. So that is not allowed in pregnancy, and we tell the endocrinologist to have a look into her medication and probably change it to propylthiouracil, which is allowed in pregnancy. So these little changes in medication go a long way to have a healthy pregnancy outcome and a healthy baby.
So doctor, I've heard about repeated abortions and then they end up with this condition called SLE. What is this condition and can it be modified?
Yeah, well, Gauri, there are women who have like repeated recurrent miscarriages. Okay. They lose one baby, the second baby is also ends up in a miscarriage. So when we go to the doctor and tell our history like this, many a times they run like tests like APLA, that is antiphospholipid antibodies. They test for it. And I also told you this antibodies, they basically cause problems in coagulation, because of which we put them on warfarin. So these women who have SLE, they are usually on warfarin, and when they are trying to become pregnant, we tell the doctors, like, you know, 6 months of remission is required in women who suffer from this disease. Okay. And once you diagnose SLE and you treat the condition, you have modified that risk factors, you see that the warfarin is converted to some drug that is like heparin, low molecular weight heparin, which is allowed in pregnancy. Okay. So a very little modification will see that she doesn't have an abortion again.
So doctor, what about people who have seizure disorders and canceritis? What do we do about them?
In such people, like epileptics will be on drugs like anti-epileptics. Yeah. Not all anti-epileptics like phenytoin, valproate is allowed in pregnancy. It's not safe in pregnancy. So they might go to their doctor and talk to the neurologist and take a shift on the, you know, stop those medicines. Okay. Not immediately, not abrupt removal of the drugs, but slowly taper it to something that, you know, has no any deleterious effects on the fetus per se if she's planning on a pregnancy. And also, cancer is something like, you know, there can be a 20-year-old or 25-year-old diagnosed with cancer. It could be the both the couple, like both the partners. Like if it's the man, they can be given an option of semen freezing. Okay. So they can go to the doctor and talk out, you know, this is the problem. So semen freezing is done. The same thing is done for the woman. Oocyte freezing can be done. And later on when they're, you know, off the disease or they are in the remission state, and when they are like advised by the doctor, it can be thawed and used, you know, when they desire a pregnancy. Because lot many drugs like, you know, chemotherapy like cyclophosphamide can have a very bad effect on the gametes. So this would probably, you know, explain how chronic conditions can be modified, how the drug use can be limited and converted to a more safe drug so that they have a healthy pregnancy.
So doctor, there are some treatments for acne and there are some drugs that are used to remove all those acnes that occur. So does that have any effect on the baby?
Yeah, there is one particular drug that is used for acne and it is not allowed in pregnancy, that is isotretinoin. So any lady who is like having acne problem and she's on some pills that like Accutane should review with her doctor and take some other medication for the same before she plans a pregnancy.
Okay. So doctor, now we have talked about all the modifications that are done. What would be the take-home message for all our viewers?
So yeah, the take-home message would be like, make a plan. If you're not ready for a pregnancy, meet a doctor, take an ideal contraception. And if you are interested in a pregnancy, start folic acid supplementation, optimize your weight, avoid all harmful substances intake like smoking, drinking, alcohol and use of substance abuse, exercise well, and also embark on this journey with a proper physical, mental and emotional health. And I would just want to pinpoint one thing, that is domestic violence is very common in the, you know, from the time, you know, and they must seek help for the same to avoid such violence. So finally, I hope everyone has got the message clear that, you know, pregnancy intervention is not when you start pregnancy, it is even before. That is all preconceptional care is all about.
Okay, thank you doctor for spending your valuable time and giving us all your knowledge. Thank you so much.
Welcome Gauri.
Okay, so dear viewers, I hope that all of you have got what our doctor said. So pre-pregnancy care is really very important. So please do follow all the takeaway messages that our doctor has given. Also like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel. Like and share our Facebook page. I'm Gauri Priya with you, and with us we had our Dr. Rajni Ramachandran, and we'll be winding up our episode.